So I'm going to call the meeting to order of March 13th, 2017. First on the agenda, approval of minutes of March 6th. Although I think you, did you have another set somewhere that you thought we had to approve? Did I?
No.
Okay, this is all we have then.
Yes.
Okay, so the minutes of last Monday. Any comments?
But I am sure though, once I'm ordered that capital.
Do I have that?
Well, we have it here.
I don't know if we have it electronically. Maybe Caroline has it.
I'm sorry, what has what?
An attachment to the minutes of last week.
The capital investing, the trust fund investing report that we received last week.
Oh, okay, good.
So I thought it would be nice to include it in the minutes. I think it'd be interesting reading.
Yes, but other than that attachment.
I had no.
From Dana, from the trustees of the trust funds. Other than that attachment that Caroline will look for and we will append, are we all right with the substance of the minutes last week?
Yeah.
Four? All right, community input?
I have a quick question.
Yes.
I know that voting has been changed and that signs and stuff are going out, from my understanding, but it went out on social media. Is there any plans to do like a reverse 911 call or anything? Do we have that capability as a town?
I don't know that we have that capability.
The police chief was sending out a Nixol alert.
She does a Nixol alert, that's not quite the same thing. So we don't have that capability. We can ask the, I wonder if the fire department does.
And is it overstepping bounds to put something in with the school call, like the school already called? But those are technically laws for residents too.
We can check. Thank you. Any other community input, community business? Is that Mr. Brunel back there?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I want to see about this.
Would you like to come up and chat with us, sir?
I'm sorry, I thought.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes, we did talk about.
This isn't the thing that I posted. The post is 5 feet high and 24 inches square. Okay, it's been hit twice before. One time, the town plow hit it and busted it, and your insurance covered it. They said that thing doesn't fall into the category you get down there. Then one time, the next time, you get, I don't know how many years later, that's been there somewhere between 35 and 40 years. Okay. Next time, there was a fire at the top of the hill. The fire truck came down, turned in the driveway across my house to turn around, facing up there, backed up, he backed into it. And the town insurance paid.
So it's not.
This, now, I was checking it over tonight, and it's 5 feet tall. Okay, there's no way the snow plow could did it. He hit it with the wing. He hit that with the wing, took one brick off and loosened a couple other bricks, and then he went over, jumped off of that pole, and went out 4 feet up onto my, 3 feet, 3.5 feet up onto my drive, on my lawn. And I know darn well, you'll have a certain distance between the road, middle of the road to where you, and you don't go 3 feet up on someone's lawn.
Well, your lawn could be in the right of way. I mean, I think that's.
But this here isn't, this is totally different. I just thought of this, you know, if you ain't going to do it, I'll get police to come up and cut it as an accident, and then turn it into your insurance company.
So.
They paid twice before, but now pay for it again.
So you're, so just so the board is clear, if, just so that we remember, there were two things of damage that you were bringing to our attention. One was the damage to the lawn, right, that was near the road. And the other is the brick, the pole.
I got two of them. He missed the first one.
Yeah.
And he hit the second one.
Okay.
And I know it couldn't have been his plow because it's up too high. He hit the top, ripped one brick off, and there's two others beyond that, that's all loose.
So we did send.
And when he did that, I don't know if he bounced off of that and went down, and that's what, they were both done at the same time, because I heard a noise out there, and the next, when I went out there to snow blow off, I found one brick down in, on the ground, and the next day I looked at it, and I said, oh my God.
So we did send the road agent to look at it and to report back, and.
I saw him up there, you know, the night I saw you, and I saw him up there the next day taking pictures, but when he says, I wouldn't trust him as father of a children, but that's neither here nor there. He doesn't impress me at all, a lot of stuff he does, okay. But anyways, I know the younger insurance will cover it, because they did twice before.
Well, and you say the mechanism is to report it as a, an accident through the police, and is that?
Right.
I mean, Caroline, do you have any experience or anything about, has this, is this something?
We can try to send it through the insurance company. I'm not, you know, it's different than a fire truck, like directly hitting it. That is, you know, a motor vehicle accident with property damage, which is different from the RSA and ordinance relative to snow removal. So they're a bit of, you know, slightly different situations that way, but nonetheless where property damage is involved. The ordinance states that the town is not liable for property damage due to snow removal, but that's to the board's discretion if you would like me to pursue that with Primex and see if they would, you know, we do have a different insurance company than we would have when this last happened, but I can pursue that and see if that's something that they would cover.
Any board, what?
$1,000 deductible.
Yes, we have a $1,000 deductible. I mean, you know, our you know, we could better find out what the right-of-way is. Do we actually know what the right-of-way is on, is it Prospect?
Prospect.
Prospect Street?
Yep.
I can look into that.
Why don't we, if we can find out exactly what the right-of-way is, then we can see where the damage took place, both to the lawn and the column. In the past, we have not repaired granite columns that have been knocked over by the plow that have been in our right of way. So, you know, there's precedent, I don't want to just say precedent, but the board, this board has felt that if, and we have a snow removal policy that says, you know, that if these structures are within the town's right of way, then the town is not responsible for their damage.
Right.
So we don't know, you know, we suspect, certainly for the lawn damage, that that's in the town's right of way. Even though you may mow it and you may seed it, you may do all kinds of things to it, it is still.
Yeah, well, they've always every year pretty much hit, but never gone up 3 feet onto my lawn. And I'm not so interested.
Right, it's the column.
About
or,
that,
right?
You know,
right.
It just kind of upset me when I saw how much he dug up there. And the only thing I can say what happened. When he hit this with his wing, evidently it flipped the wing up and then come back down and dug way up there. I mean, that's where he was that far in. And that's why, and I know it had to be the wing because his plow ain't no 5 feet up. So he had, must have had the wing up or something, because I got the next one and that's when it was that way. And I know it had, and those brick were all cemented in and everything. They were specially made. Right there in place. I'd say somewhere between 30 and 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And, but they're not that, can't really say that too, because one of them had, the first one coming up, not going down Prospect Street, coming up Prospect Street, the town wrecked it with the plow truck. I mean, it really wrecked it. And the insurance company paid for the whole thing to be done. Okay. Now the one that's got hit this time, when the fire was at the house at the top of the hill, the truck came down, turned around in the driveway over there, and backed up, and he backed up into it. And that's when, that the town insurance paid to have that repaired. And those are the only two times that anything's ever happened. He did so much damage to the first one, the town truck did, that I didn't know about it. But at the time, the selectman was living across the street. And when I got the next day, I says, where the heck is it? It was all busted. And he come over and he says, the town truck did it last night. He said, I saw him when I was out. I heard the noise, I was looking out the window and he did it. That's when I knew when I went. And at that time, it was Fergus and Insurance and they were down here. Had an office on Front Street. I don't remember exactly where, but it was, and I went down there and they said, just go get it done, give us the bill and we'll pay for it. And both times, that's the way it was. I don't remember now if I had, I think I did get police report and stuff given to them. I don't remember that.
Well,
but I know they both paid for it anyways.
Here's what we can do, is we can try to more accurately ascertain what the right-of-way is.
Mm-hmm.
And see where the...
I know it goes so many feet from the center of the road.
It depends.
The town has.
It depends on the road, though. It varies.
They may not.
Varies.
Through the lawn. But I mean, it's, you know, I've never seen it done that. If you go up there and you see it, you ain't going to believe it.
Okay. That's true that I have not seen that.
I measured, before coming down, I measured exactly what, you know, from the tar to where it ends up there is a little over 3 feet.
Right, but it kind of depends from the middle of the road to where the...
Well, I didn't measure from the middle of the road.
So that's the measurement that's important, because depending on what the right-of-way is, it will tell us where, so...
I didn't measure the right-of-way.
So we'll,
I just measured...
Understand. So we'll try to figure out...
I just never saw it ever that before. Sometimes it goes up 6 or 8 inches or maybe a foot. But I've never seen my lawn not ripped up 3 feet.
I understand.
And then that's when I said, maybe when you hit that, the wind come down.
It's possible.
I don't know what happened.
Yeah.
I went out there when it happened, so
sure.
I don't know.
So
but I know the next day when I went out to use a snowboard, there was a brick. One of the bricks is off completely, and the others, there's some over there behind it that's loose. And I mean, it ain't like it's a small post and can't see it.
It's, right, I don't think it's that. It's
no,
just,
it's,
you know,
five
it's
feet,
difficult.
It's 5 feet high and 2 foot square.
You're right. Snow plowing in the middle of a storm is not always the easiest thing, and trucks can slip a little bit. So, but let's find out if we can about what the right-of-way is on Prospect Street, and then we'll get back to you again.
Okay.
Thank you so much for coming in. Do you have anything else to say, questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I was very pleased that you talked to me that night.
Well, we would of course talk to you.
Then I said, well, I kept thinking it all and remember how it went. And I said, I'll just go down and tell them that I'll get in touch with the police, have them come up.
That's always a prerogative.
Give the report to your insurance company.
Yeah. All right. Well, nice to see you
again.
Thank you. Any other community input?
Good evening. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks. How are you?
Hi. How's it going?
Okay. I'm just...
Mr. On...
Wizard. On building permit. I spoke to Tom Clark about it.
Yep.
Right here.
Oh, good.
It's an $85 fixture. It's up 2017-020, so 18 Pine Crest Lane.
That's it, Mr. Wilson, Pine Crest Lane.
$85 has been
approved by Tom.
By Mr. Moore.
Yep.
So, permit granted.
There we go.
Sign.
You can take the, we don't always have our administrative assistant slash bookkeeper slash jack of all trades.
She does everything around
here. She does.
You have a nice night, folks?
Thanks.
I got fresh bread to go finish baking, so.
All right, take care.
We'll be over after.
Any other community input?
I got fresh bread and baking.
Department head business, nothing under, or building inspector's not here, I don't see a fire. Highway.
He's supposed to be in.
Okay, so we'll wait. I know Chief Ducharme's not in. Welfare, is that why Carolyn's here? All right, it says Case right here. All right, so, we'll give a couple of minutes. Do you want to talk about these POs while waiting for them? So I got a call from Aaron LeChance, our HTA engineer, and they're really wanting to get the wetland permits in place, to keep that process moving. And so the permits themselves cost money, so I have a purchase order for, I'll give one to each of you. One is for Pine Street, which is the more important of the two. One is for the Lower Mill. We think the Willie Street one isn't gonna cost anything, I don't know why. So I'll give one to each of you and give a little entertainer motion on those. And it will come out of the culvert reserve fund.
What number do you have?
1155.
All right, I move purchase order number 1154 to the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services for culvert wetland permit for Pine Street for $205.80.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Want to see?
1154.
No.
Move to accept purchase order 1155 to New Hampshire DES for culvert wetland permit for the Lower Mill culvert for $200.
I'll second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Also from the culvert. Okay, so he's all set?
He's all set.
Okay, I think we just did the POs for the culverts.
Wonderful, thank you.
And I think I will entertain a motion for non-public.
I'm gonna go to the non-public session, social care and welfare petition.
Second.
Roll call, Michael?
Yes.
Jody? Suzanne, yes.
It's like I emailed you about the zoning and I got with her about zoning. So she's on top of it, I'm hoping, but it's up to you at least.
Yeah, I don't know if you've heard yet.
Just a bit.
Sorry, we've been dealing with snow accumulations already.
All right, Martin, can you do this then?
Oh, yeah, so for the select board, case number 2015-007, they're recommending, I can't read my own handwriting, $637.50 in rentals.
Second.
$637.50.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a second as well. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you, Carolyn.
We had some last week.
We had two last week. Sorry.
This case.
Yes, yes.
$840 or something?
No.
No.
Oh.
That case was $212.50 last week.
Just curious.
All right, Jeff.
How's it going?
Hi. You did walk in. We already had a conversation even, I.
Yeah, I heard all about it. They're still going at it.
All right, so what you got for us?
A couple purchase orders tonight. 937 to Bob's Golf, and it's for when the F-550 was hit. So a tow bill for $140, and I believe the insurance is paying for that.
Okay, so do we get the, let me go first. I move purchase order number 937 to Bob's Golf for towing for $140.
Second.
So, so we have to pay first and the insurance company's gonna reimburse us, what typically happens? But we don't know if we.
Well, I would say, you know, it's a small business, and, you know, the question is whether, you know, we should try to pay him.
No, I'm not objecting. I'm just asking procedurally. Is that what we're understanding?
Yeah, I would state, he does our towing in town and stuff, so. I'm sure the insurance company will be reimbursed. I'm not sure how it all works.
We can ask Caroline. I think she's Is she still here?
Alex, I don't know.
That's how my insurance works.
You pay and they get reimbursed?
Yeah, I think so too, but.
Pardon?
I get reimbursed.
Yeah, I think so too, but.
Yeah, all right, so you're okay with this too, all right, so ready to call a question?
Yeah, no, I'm just, yes.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Just curious.
5 gallons of hydraulic fluid is to Federated Auto for $70.27, it's going out of my supplies.
Let's see.
The purchase order 936 to Federated Auto for 5 gallons of hydraulic oil for $70.27.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Repurchase order 935 to Allied Equipment for a spray tension or spring for the plow that goes on the International Plow Truck, which is a longer bull wing, for $172.63. That wing is 5 years old, so we'll put a few dollars into it.
Oh, spring, I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
Yes, spring.
Okay, I move purchase order number 935 to Allied Equipment for one spring for the wing on the International Plow Truck for $172.63.
Seconded.
Any discussion?
Is this, did this break or is it just maintenance?
Regular maintenance. What happens is the springs lose their tension after a while and your wing won't stay upright, it'll just keep holding it.
Ms. Curtis?
Yep, all set. All those in favor say aye.
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 Last but not least, purchase order 933 to Fastenal for $101.14. And this is for chains for one, chain for one of the plows from Travis's.
How much is it for? $141.50?
No, $101.14.
I like that. I like that, I want it.
Not unless there's other small bills and she just got one check.
Must have done that.
Yeah, there is a bill down there.
Okay.
You might want to look at it. Move to accept purchase order 933 to Fastenal for hardware for bin chain for plow.
Yeah.
For $101.14.
Second.
Any discussion?
I can vote, I'm good on it.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, then okay, that one.
It's a half inch chain for a plow, it's like $6.70 a foot, so it's.
Oh, it's not that, we just have a check that I'm not supposed to sign until we do a PO, and I thought that was it. If it was, I would just sign it now, so.
Is it to Fastenal?
Yeah, it's gonna be, there might be another, Jody's right, there's probably another bill in here on top and I'll.
We'll figure it out.
Once things slow down, of course.
Okay. Okay.
Does the board have anything for me tonight?
Question. So the 550 is back up and running and in the fleet?
Yep.
Ready for tomorrow?
Yep.
What's the state of the other trucks?
Good, everything's back.
Okay, well, thank you, congratulations.
Yes.
But just made it.
Yeah.
Yeah, everything's good. I know.
Highway shed roof, we're still waiting for a second call.
I haven't heard, yeah, I haven't heard from the guys I called. I don't know if they're just busy or if they're just.
All right, we'll keep it on the agenda. Murphy?
Yeah, because we're losing more and more shingles. And with them shingles, they're blowing nails off into our parking lot, which is gonna create a flat tire at some point in time, so.
Well, yeah, we must start with them to fix it, so it might be 2 weeks now. But do you wanna go ahead and accept that?
Do we have it? Do we still have it?
It might be in my folder.
It says. I'm just gonna hand it over to somebody who knows what to look for.
Okay, so.
It doesn't have an upper limit, right?
No, unfortunately.
Yeah, so.
So it's $125 approximate materials, two men at 4 hours at $65 a man.
Oh, he did do that.
Yeah.
Okay, so what is?
As, do we wanna put a limit on that?
Well, we could, can we just do the math here? What is the?
Cap it.
We've also been losing more shingles, Jeff said, so.
Right.
That was a few weeks ago, wasn't it?
So we could just say, you know, $1,000, I mean, that, as a purchase order, if we were to do, can you get us a blank purchase order?
I have a sheet.
So we're just doing that, just hold it up.
What are you thinking, Mike?
No, I was thinking about tomorrow, nothing you need from.
We got a pocket man in effect, so.
Yeah, we're not voting tomorrow, so we prevented that nightmare.
Everybody's,
School is canceled.
Yeah. Yeah, we should be in good shape.
Okay. Oh, you know, I want, well, are you still voting, Betty? Oh, no, we're looking, yeah, I wanted to give you that, actually. So last Thursday, or Friday, rather, when we had that minor weather.
Everything turned to a sheet of ice.
Everything was a sheet of ice, so I drove from Bedford, Manchester to Rollins. And when I got to Raymond, that's when things got bad. The only two communities that really had been plowed, and they were all state roads until I got to Dover and Rollins. Rollins and Dover were the only two towns that were properly maintained, so thank you. Division Six apparently forgot to drop any salt between where they come off onto 155 off of, what the heck, that's not Badger Road, it's a.
Little Worth.
Thank you.
Knox Marsh.
Way down in Durham, right before the, we get onto Route Four, whatever the name of that road is, I haven't worked on that, so I don't remember, but anyways. You go down 155 and typically cross into Durham from the Lee, there's a little big beautiful house with pond in it. With a sheet of ice there, and the Madbury Police and Police, a fire department were actually out with a little scoop throwing salt mix onto to 155 so we could get through it, because it's a lot of, so thank you. And your team for what you did.
I'll pass it on to the guys, I'm sure they'll appreciate it.
Mentioned a Division Six, they might want to drop some salt if they drive along too.
Yeah, this is, like I said, this is a new guy that just took over in the area, and he's, you gotta say.
I guess. Did I kill enough time with the?
Yes.
It was sincere, I mean.
Who would like to move, who would like to?
Move to accept purchase order 1156, to MJ Murphy and Sons Roofing for replacing missing shingles on garage roof.
Highway Department.
Where, at the Highway Department, proposal dated 2/17/17 for up to $1,000.
Awesome.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 I believe in your blue filled folder also, you'll see a quote from Townsend Energy for that.
Yeah, what is that?
That's for that furnace that is leaking propane. We bought, remember, probably 3 years ago now, we ordered a, for the warm room up top for the compactors.
All right, that's, we weren't sure where this was going.
It was like a whopping, I don't know, $99 or something. Well, you can't do nothing with it, they can't fix it, they can't do nothing with it, so now it's leaking gas by and.
Is it this alone?
Yeah, it's just a little here.
A little unit, right?
So, what I'm hoping to do is purchase something that Townsend Energy can service and maintain.
What is the cost on it?
It's like $1,200.
$1,390.
$1,390.
So, do we not have any heat at all in there right now?
Yeah, this heat.
We're gonna have to wait until Saturday, I think it's over before we can roll.
Yeah, no, this heat, but they just, you can't, they open up all the doors and everything before they start it, so.
Fair enough, so I don't want.
So what is the board, does the board think we should wait till, do it now, should we wait till after, tell me? $1,300?
Yeah, it's leaking?
Yeah, I mean, it's.
It doesn't start right.
But if our bond comes through, if the transfer station improvements come through, is this gonna be part of that improvement?
No.
The heater wasn't part of it, no.
No, the heater's.
But are we gonna have to rebuild that shed anyway for the wire?
But what we could do is take that new, and take that new heater, and we could put it in the shed. When we put another compactor up there, we're just gonna have one shed, we're just gonna have two controls in one shed. So we'll take that heater, if the town's still planning on updating that shed up top, we'll take that heater, transfer it over to the newer shed.
So it's not part of the current plan? plan, but the budget that we formulated, or the purposes for transfer station improvements, and we've given, you know, some of the large components of that. Is it possible if some of these components that are in there come in at less and we have, we could pay for it out of there? I think that's possible. It's a question of timing more than anything else.
Also, now they have our new budget, huh? I know it's not approved here, I'm just, understand that, but I just want to see the highway.
What is the maintenance for the?
Yeah.
It's not highway, it's transfer station.
Transfer station, rather, that's what I meant.
We've been in a government building, Mike. It's not under.
The first line, that's right.
It's in the government. Yeah, it's near the, you know, beginning as opposed to the end.
Government building, too. Transfer station, repairs and maintenance, transfer station. So if our budget actually is adopted as proposed by the select board by the town meeting, it's $2,000. No, wait, sorry. $7,500 is the proposed appropriation size.
For maintenance?
For maintenance.
$7,500?
No, that's the fire station, $3,000. Apparently I can't read this evening, I'm sorry. So it was $3,000.
I was gonna say, wow.
Yeah, I was gonna say that myself.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Looking at the wrong line, sorry, it's the one below it, everyone calm down. So I made a mistake, let's, I'll say that louder again. I made a mistake. It's okay. Had a mistake with my house. The compactor shed, we have a note here for $2,000. All right.
To build a new one.
To rebuild the shed. So what I'm just suggesting is if, all things considered, if we actually get the budget we proposed to the town meeting, really only have, we're going to have to find something else somewhere to cover the rest of it. If you want to go forward with it tonight, that's all I'm saying.
We can wait probably another week.
I mean, if it's a safety issue, I don't want to.
Well, if it's a, yeah, so if it's a safety issue. It's reusable. So the question's going to be, I mean, I think what you're addressing, Mike, is if we have to rebuild that little shed, then we may not have sufficient funds in that little.
If our budget is not
made whole.
Made whole, and we can go with the reduction.
Yes, we're in trouble.
Budget. Well, right, we have to reprioritize a number of things. So
either way,
we would say we want a cheaper unit, is what I'm saying. We might have to say, let's get another disposable for 100 versus, and not, that's not my.
I think it was more than 100, but I want to say it was like around 300 and some change.
Okay, that's still $1,000 left than what we're talking about right now, so.
And that's not including the next dollar.
Fair enough. I don't want the 1,300 doesn't include on.
Oh, that's a complete unit. But what I'm saying, if I'm off and I don't know that, it's not, you know, we take delivery of it and then we have to have them install it because it's propane and gas. So you're looking at a charge to install it also.
I don't know. Do I wait till the end of the week or?
Well, now that I hear that this one's leaking.
Yeah, fair enough, yeah.
I don't want this to be a Roman candle with someone getting,
you know, really
hard. I don't know.
I'm just going by what the technician said. I'm not.
Yeah, so
okay.
Who has it?
I don't have it.
I have.
I didn't do a PO with it.
Pardon?
Three.
Come grab a stack.
I was going to say, a couple things.
Our auditor wants us to have POs.
No, that's fine.
Otherwise, he does this to us.
Well, she's getting that. I have other questions.
Yes.
So we had a bid for the sweeper back in October.
Yeah.
The bid deadline has passed. Estimate expires February 4th. So to even address this, do you need to go back to Bobcat?
I'll just go back to Bobcat and see if the numbers are still the same.
Okay. Do you want this back?
No, I'll just call it.
Okay. So I'm just going to wait on Jeff.
We were going to wait on that until after town
meeting. Yeah,
I think you weren't there.
But we'll
need to figure out the date. Thank you, Salma. Oh, I see you've got us an extra one, too.
I did.
So that's forward thinking.
We won't need it now, definitely. Thank you.
Well, what am I doing? Put it back.
This one.
Right.
For Townsend. Okay. Five Center Road could be any larger. And this is also, this is the transfer station.
Yes.
Well, she's writing that out. Do you know anything about changing the rails in front of town hall? Does the wait to talk to Richard?
I talked to him, so I will be able to.
Okay, he's at the bottom of the pile.
So what is this for again?
It is for a.
Vent-free wall furnace.
Positive that can be reused that way.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, this is a, it's a legit unit, it's not something.
Final proposal, can you give me a date on that, Julie, please?
January 10th.
Okay. And it's 13. Okay, Mike, want to do this one?
Sure. New purchase order number 1158 to Townsend Energy for.
It's a vent, yeah, that's the main.
Oh, okay, oh, Vernai, okay, a vent-free wall furnace, no, I'm sorry. And installation for $1,398.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Mr. Brunel was in tonight about his, the damage on his. And he feels quite strongly that the wing of the plow is what damaged his.
Nope. Where the damage was done on his post is approximately 5 feet out. Our wings are at 42 inches.
Well, he says that they loosened something lower and they may have knocked that one off.
I didn't see no damage. You know, if we hit something lower, we would have seen the damage to that structure that we hit, and we would have felt it. So, any damage that I've ever done around town, I notify the police department, even as small as a mailbox.
So, well, that, I wish I'd known that, I would have said that. So,
yeah.
Our standard operating procedure.
I personally, so there's record of it. You know, if I hit a mailbox, yeah. and I know
do,
about it.
And do all your plowers do the same?
Absolutely. They notify me, and then I notify the police department. With even the smallest little thing.
So whose route is that?
That's Mike Dionne's.
It's Mike's, okay, so and he's been around.
So his ring is his ring.
A long time,
like 30 inches.
He knows that he has to.
Yep.
It's not like it's a new person that.
When his grass got ripped up, it was when we got them two, like 18 inch storms back to back.
Right.
And Mike was starting to lose his road.
So he pushed it back, and you said that. So,
so I went in front of him, where my truck's heavier. And my wings bigger and heavier, and we pushed everything back, and he followed me. And whatever fell out in the road, he pushed it back.
Okay. Do you feel that this could have happened then with the?
I would have felt it in my truck.
Could the pushing the snow have inadvertently done? Because it was already loose, not anything that we had done.
Yeah, I can't answer, but.
But is that that's a possibility?
I don't know.
Well, we just said.
But I know if I hit it, or one of the guys hit it, there would have been a police report on it. There would have been property damage, and none of us hit it. If a wing came up and bumped up and hit it, the toe of the wing would have dug in the ground. You know, when it came up and slapped the ground. So your wing just don't bounce up 4 feet and just land back down smoothly. If it bounces up, the toe of the ground's gonna, the toe of the wing's gonna stick in the ground, and it's gonna come up and hit the truck because that's how it works.
Thank you. I mean, we just, you know, we need to respond, so.
Yeah. Like I said, I don't believe that we did any damage. damage his property.
Okay.
Did we tear up a little bit of grass on the edge of the road?
Yeah, we know that, he knows that, and so we're managing.
But the post, if you're going, if you, the pictures don't do it justice, but if the board goes and looks at it, then post, all the mortar is all cracked on both of the posts.
How far up into the driveway is the post there? I didn't notice on the picture, I didn't.
Probably like 2-3 feet.
Okay, so it's not in the right of way or anything, it's above that, right?
I don't know what the right of way is on that question.
Off the top of your head, but we might not have it, okay.
So the other thing, Jeff, is that we sent a letter about water discharge to the wrong folks, so we sent another letter, the Foundry Street thing.
Though, really?
No, I took a picture and I actually showed Caroline, I took a picture of the water coming out of the house, I took a picture of that.
Not you.
No, not you, us.
A letter that went out, went to the wrong folks.
Okay, I'm like, I know I sent the right pictures.
Yeah.
But, so I asked a question, so is this, those are the folks that responded to us, right?
No.
Oh, so the letter that she forwarded that said it needed to be fixed didn't have the new name on it, that's why.
Oh, yeah, right.
When I saw.
I mean, this started because I got a letter from the folks who live at 414 Fourth Street.
Right.
Said, I think there's, you made a mistake, and they were right, we did make a mistake.
Yeah, right.
So this is the.
That makes a lot more sense.
Yeah, this is the letter to the right person, so I'll just sign it, it's a water discharge letter to 414 Foundry Street. So I just wanted you to know that we did try and had an administrative error, so.
So, I don't know, you can see the pictures that you got it here. But the edge of the road, as you can see, is right here.
Sure.
On Manel's property. That's his post.
Oh, I see, it's got a little thing around it.
So.
So it's pushed back, but it's not like right on the road.
It's not right on the edge, but we would never do damage all the way up here. Our wings.
Down there.
Down here.
I mean, he.
So if we were to hit this.
He mentioned that there was damage, loose bricks behind, wasn't it, is that what he said?
He said, yeah, he thought it loosened some bricks as well as.
I don't know, I'll have to go over next one.
Yeah, you know, if you want, I'll call the police department and I'll get a report started on it, if that's, but I.
Whatever we think is the right thing to do, I mean, I just know that he, you know, he's still feeling that.
He was wrong.
He was wrong. So the best that we can do right now is to try to determine the right of way, just at least for the, just to see what the right of way is.
The ordinance does say though that we don't replace, it does say just mailbox, I don't remember.
I don't know exactly what it says.
I believe you when it says any damage dumped to property.
Even if it's on there, not out of the right of way?
I don't know what the right of way is.
It's the right of way.
Yeah, we have to check on that.
I'm pretty confident it's just the right of way, so.
It doesn't seem to make sense that if you.
Right.
Right.
I'm gonna say as far as the wing jumping up and.
It seems like it would be.
It's not responsible for property, responsible for damage to private property that is located within the public right of way.
So that's the key.
Right.
The right of way could be up to 50 feet wide and is often confused by property owners as their own property.
High Street's 40 feet and 50 feet spots.
Yep.
Gordon Hoyle and Dana.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. Anything else for Jeff?
That's wide of a road.
Okay.
All right, Jeff. So we're holding till after town meeting, electrical issues on backhoe?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of that, Chadwick Bayross will be coming back because it's gone into a regen mode, it's regen 4 times in the last 2 days. Because it's got issues. So, they're gonna try and get that covered under emissions.
Okay.
But. And what it does when it goes in, the machine will go into like a limp mode, which you get no power from it. It's, you know, you can lend it back to the shop, but.
So these are computer-based issues with the.
It's just an electrical nightmare, the whole machine's been electrical issues.
It's not a mechanical issue, it's actual.
It has had some mechanical issues, but I believe they resolved them, but yeah, it's going to be an ongoing issue for the town with this machine, unfortunately.
Okay. So Mick and construction hauling of snow?
Yep.
So approximately 264 loads of snow?
Yep.
To the town of Dover?
They, they did roof and mill. They were supposed to resend one, but that's what was there for machine, and then the two trucks, and that's our hourly rate, we scratched that out, so that's what it came up to. That's what hourly was last year too, I believe.
So they didn't take it to Dover, so they took it to Rollins, they took it to our transfer station?
Yeah. Yeah, it was about a load every 5 to 6 minutes they got, all.
I don't know what the problem is, so.
So, snow removal in Dover.
Well, we're gonna bring that down, we need a load.
Oh, I see. So, is the, and then there was something crossed out, why is this thing crossed out?
Because they charged us for a piece of equipment that they didn't use.
Well, is this really our invoice, I think that's what Jody's trying to.
That's what we're all asking, I think.
If you want, I'll have, make sure it's in one.
Yeah, I think it's worth having somebody review this.
But as far as the equipment that was there, the two trucks and the loader.
Yeah, but see where it says snow removal in Dover, and then one of these things, you know, wasn't even.
Crossing something out.
I think it'd be good to have somebody review it, that's my thing.
264 loads, how big was the truck?
Triaxles. The round was about every 5 to 7 minutes.
Oh, that's good.
Oh, yeah.
What's up?
I mean, there was a lot of snow, I understand that, but it just seems like.
Yeah, if we could have, maybe you could review with Carol, yeah.
I'll be making a lot.
Thank you.
And that's it for me.
Sorry about that, I thought they were gonna resend one, I did talk to them, I did confront them.
Yeah.
That last piece, it was crossed off.
Yeah, it's just making us uneasy. Okay. Anything else of Jeff?
Good luck.
Yes, have a good night's sleep.
Please.
Get some rest, weekend.
Depending on how crazy things are at my home, I can text you tomorrow before.
Yeah, take a ride, yeah, take a ride with the guy that owns the downtown.
Yeah, I'm not allowed to do that.
All right, thanks.
Good night, Jeff.
Good night, Jeff. All right, we are on to town administration.
Said you talked to Richard.
Oh, yeah, do you wanna do this now?
Sure.
All right, so, and this repair is just for the railing? That's outside of town hall. So this is kind of, actually, this is what this little drawing was, but I didn't know it at the time, so. If this is the front entrance, this is the railing that gets in your way when you open the door.
Yeah, sure.
Right, so they're gonna cut it off here and just move it there.
Okay.
And if you wanna go out and take a look, and if you wanna take a look.
Do you mind me saying, do it feel so real quick, though?
No, I think, yeah, it's right out there, so let's, I can show you, because I needed to see.
Can I get off, have a little exercise?
It is. So I'll go take a look, can I? So, happy little.
Well balanced.
Lots of carbs.
I was gonna say carbs.
Okay. Result of the board's field trip. Is that we're not convinced that it's the right thing to do. We want to think about it some more, so we're gonna hold off.
So, yeah, listen, I don't want to be a dead horse, but this was a suggestion of, who was it, the fire department or our insurance carrier?
The fire department, I think.
Okay.
Probably went under the joint loss inspection.
Yeah.
I'll double check with that. That's after town meeting.
Perfect.
I want to say a week or two after.
Add things to your already long list of things to do, but.
All right, are you ready to go on?
Please.
All right, so with regards to town meeting, I do have the warrant so that we can see who's going to speak to certain things. And I've made the slideshow. I've made slides too. I haven't approved them yet because I became all of a sudden indisposed. But they will look like this. Can you see?
That's the
when we get to the real ones. Yeah, those are a lot too. I mean,
yeah, well, it is what it is.
It is what it is, right?
Okay, so it's just the article.
Yeah, each article is just a slide.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Right? They get easier to read as they get less worried.
Okay.
All right, so that's the slides. And I've got the warrant here. So they start with the bond warrants. I would really like to speak to the bond warrants.
You want to do all three?
We can look to you if there's something that we want to have said about the transfer station in particular. Does that work?
Yes, we'll
And I'm not sure, you know, how much to say for each of these, other than to kind of repeat sort of what the voting guide has already said, mm-hmm. and let the questions go. And of course, with regard to the fire engine, you know, we can ask the moderator if our chief can answer questions.
He's a resident anyway, so we can't.
That's true too. Yeah. Does that work for everybody?
Sure, that's what I want. I mean, I thought you'd want to divvy them up, but if you
want to. I do want to divvy others up, but.
No, I meant those, but if you want to, I'm not hearing you.
Well, I have a strong.
We can
deal for them.
We can have, interject when necessary. So.
Absolutely. I also feel strongly about the operating budget, but I'm willing to.
Do I hear a number 9? You want to go for 9?
No. If willing to, I'm happy to speak to all of them. I'll be perfectly honest with you, but I think it's important to have the board.
I agree.
Yeah. So, and we can actually go back and revisit some of those bond warrants if you think.
No, that's fine. All
right. So, road resurfacing, sidewalk repairs, and road drainage.
I don't know if you want me to like that. I'm happy to do it. Or Jody feels strongly about it.
Well, let's ask it this way. Let's start this. Are there any of these remaining articles, starting with 9, over which either one of you feels that you would really like to speak to?
If they have any questions, Article 21 about the motor vehicle registration.
Yep, okay.
Why Kate brought it to our attention, and I thought it was a good idea.
Yep. So, Jody, we'll let you speak to that. All right, sounds good. What about the top one too? Because they actually go together. The transportation.
Yes.
I'll take 22. The one.
Oh yeah.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You
have
the rest.
That's okay. I truly don't mind. No, but there are things, the sort of things like the land surveys. I mean, that's a nice one to talk about. And the town reval is a nice one to talk about. I mean, it's, you know, has to be done. But conservation land, I'm happy. I'm more than happy to talk about all of that. I'll say it again. But I also feel it's important for the board to sort of. All right. So let's go back. So road resurfacing. if no one has a strong feeling that they want to do it, I'll do it. How about if I phrase it that way? But if I'm if you have a strong feeling that you want to do it.
I don't mind doing it, I mean.
Okay, Mike. Town hall drainage. I'll take it. Town hall security. Which is actually one we could, you know, ask Bob to help with as well. All right. I'll take it.
I'll do it, I'm sorry, if you want.
Mike, town hall security. Public safety communications.
You want me to continue that threat, that theme? I mean, I don't mind.
That's good. The command vehicle for the Rollinsford Fire Department?
Kitchens.
Oh, no.
Okay. I'll do it. The truck for the highway department?
Won't we be just be pointing to our department heads on this?
There are things we might want to say also, though. You know, I mean, it's important to say.
Well, I think you just sort of set it up.
Yeah, and it's important to say that where the money's coming from, that there's no tax impact, or when there is a tax impact, like for the roads, that nonetheless, the tax impact of everything is somewhere between 0 cents and 4 cents. That's the sort of thing that we have to keep mentioning, including, and that 0 to 4 cents is with the operating budget as we originally proposed it. All right, so where are we?
In the truck for the highway department?
I'd be happy to.
I'm back.
How about capital improvement? You're on that,
sure.
Mike? Okay. Conservation land trust fund? That's a nice one. Jerry, you want to do that one?
No.
Okay, I'll do it. Town rebound? Whoever does that one should do the next one too, so I'm happy to do it. I'll do the town rebound and the town rebound.
Oh, the fund, and then
yes.
Should I do the next three?
Conservation land? Yeah, unless you would like to do conservation land? All right, make next one up for mine.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'll put you in between you. So I've got the two revals. Land surveys and related expenses. Going once, going twice. Okay. All right, so here's what I have. I have, if you were doing the bond warrants and the operating budget, Mike doing Article 9 road resurfacing. Hewer doing Article 10 town hall drainage. Mike doing Article 11 town hall security. Mike doing Article 12 public safety communication. Hewer doing Article 13 command vehicle for the fire department. Hewer doing Article 14 service truck for the highway department. Mike doing Article 15 CIP reserve fund. Mike doing Article 16, Conservation Land Trust Reserve Fund. Hewer doing Article 17 and 18 on the town rebound. Hewer doing Article 19 on land surveys. Jody doing Articles 20 and 21 on the one with Transportation Improvement Capital Reserve Fund, and the other on the motor vehicle registration. Mike doing Article 22 and Article 23 doesn't really need anything, I don't think, but. We'll see if it
does also be good.
Okay.
I write off the words.
Yeah, okay, perfect. That's true, yeah, okay, that's true. Perfect. So, okay, so I think we're good. The one thing I would say, Jody, and I don't even know how to address it there, but Articles 20 and 21 are in that order because of how we have to put them, but actually the only reason for Article 20 is Article 21, you know what I mean, so.
We have to tell them that we're doing Article 21,
yeah.
So if you pass Article 20, if you pass Article 21, we have some place to put that.
Exactly. Okay. And if we don't pass Article 21, it will be a reserve fund that has no money going to it. So, okay. All right, I think we're good.
Well, cart before the horse thing.
Yeah, but that's the way it has to be, and yep. There was, if there's a question too, and we'll be there to remember this, but that there was a little bit of time when I spoke to the budget committee about maybe they had to recommend that, because maybe we had to put a buck in it, do you remember that, Nancy? Well, we didn't know that. When I went back to DRA, there was, I was pointed to another way to enter the warrant article, which didn't require us to put any money in it, so it gave it, it led it so that we didn't have to make any changes to our operating budget, we didn't have to have any other recommendations. All right, are we good there? Super. Let me, find my agenda. I think, I have to say that I didn't really scour this agenda. This was an unusual week, I'm sorry for that. So, we've already talked about childcare at meeting. We can send out a reminder, you know, this week on the email site. I did speak to our bond counsel about all of these shenanigans here today, and you heard that she wrote back and she said she was fine, there was no issue with moving the elections. You know, the business meeting stays the same, so that was good there. We're not gonna deal with recirculating pump quotes at the moment. You know, so now we have Thursday elections and board presence, so, yeah, I'll be here.
You will be?
Okay, I'll be here. Comcast franchise renewal is a placeholder until after the town meeting. Building permit, this was an oddity, it was a surprise to Caroline, but I got an email from Mr. Sterrick. Did I forward it along to you?
Well, I don't know what you've got in the last few days.
Locust Street Siding, and he wrote just to me, I don't know how he got my name, and he said, "I received a letter of concern from you last week." And so I got this March 9th, last week, about me replacing the siding on my house and whether I needed a building permit or not. And Caroline doesn't remember sending a letter to this address, so we're not even sure. Again, it was 514 Locust Street. But in any event, he says he's in the process of painting, simply replacing a few miscellaneous broken or cracked pieces here and there,
yeah.
Blah, blah, blah. You know, the cost is like, just in the hundreds, well below the $1,500 threshold.
And I don't remember ever sending him, I think.
So I wrote back and said, thank you for getting, and I did copy you on this, and Tom. I said, thanks for getting back to us regarding the issue of a building permit. Based upon the description of your activity, it certainly sounds like you did not need a permit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm copying the select board and our building inspector to ensure that your response has adequately answered our concerns. If you don't hear from us by next Tuesday, which is tomorrow, then we are all in agreement. Good luck with your home, blah, blah, blah.
We sent the letter October 17th. To 519 Locust for siding, same name.
Mm-hmm. That's it, 519 Locust. Mm-hmm. You got it last week?
In October.
519.
Yeah, 519, that's what I said.
No, you said 514.
Well, sorry, 519.
Okay. Well, this letter is dated October 17th for siding.
To 519?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, all right, well, he's responding.
He just got the letter last week, though?
Well, I received a letter of your concern from you last week. So he says. Now Caroline did say something about maybe he doesn't live there, maybe he's a property owner, maybe.
And a forward.
I don't know. So in any event, it was because of siding. Somebody must have seen him doing siding.
Okay.
So he's responding.
Okay.
So he has to go in the forward anyways.
Yeah.
Right, but I mean it was about siding. So
I'm remembering a letter.
I do remember
he
that.
He might have been doing siding in October, and now he's just touching up. I don't know.
That's a good point.
I think even then we weren't sure that he was really doing his old house, as I recall.
Okay.
Section that I did strip off, the section along the driveway, which has cost all of $100. So, he got a contractor to say the most it would have been cost would be around 200, which is way below the blah, 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 so. So we'll just let it, let this one go. All right, go back to the agenda. Fire engine. So I don't know if I've ordered along, I got some hopeful news from DES that EPA is, you know, looking sort of positively on our need to extend that, so that's all I can say on that. USDA loan application, we got the sign of approval from the engineer finally and all of the engineering stuff. So we got the intergovernmental review, which was green light on the culverts and sort of yellow light on the transfer station, only because one reviewer said, well, it's conditional based on whether or not there are wetlands and stuff like that, where, and there are no wetlands, so.
The wetlands where?
Transfer station.
Oh, okay.
We didn't file an environmental section because
right,
we had talked it over with them, with USDA, and they said we didn't need one after our conversation. But this intergovernmental reviewer doesn't know that.
Right, right.
So that's why that person said conditional, but I don't think that that's an issue. Okay, are we ready to go on to the rec committee? I think there's a few things to review.
Sorry, I'm sending you guys
emails.
That's
okay.
That's okay. Let's
go for it.
So, they wanted you to revisit the walking situation for older kids, first off.
Okay, so do you want us to tackle that?
Yes.
So, when you say revisit, I don't know exactly what does that mean, because
we as a board decided that there would be no walkers and that the parents would have to sign them in and out.
Mm-hmm.
There would have to be a grower. You can't have an 8-year-old walk in and I'm here.
Yeah, no.
And then there would be.
They want to revisit that?
They wanted us to revisit that for older kids because kids live close enough where they can sleep in and show up.
What age?
I was going to say, what are they considering older
like
kids?
Like 6th, 7th, 8th grade. Because they're allowed to be there up until 8th grade.
I don't run these kinds of programs. So is there any guides like that from some of the other communities that run these programs?
Yeah, Summersworth paper that said that they do make a parent sign something kind of like what we had last year anyway.
Yeah.
Problem is, like last year, we don't know who's not going to show up.
Right.
Like people are like, well, I get to walk to school. Well, yeah, you also have this somebody calling saying Johnny's
not
here.
Here. Yeah.
Right.
So are they going to have the staff and manpower to do that?
Yeah.
So, Summersworth does have that.
Have the ability to walk with a certificate from a certain age on.
Doesn't give an age. Just says my child has permission to circle one, walk to and from camp. Or ride a bike with a helmet to and from camp. I permit my child to leave camp at the following time.
But right now all they're asking us for is the first one about walking.
No, signing out too. They also wanted to know if older brother or sister could sign them in and out. That's not 18. So you have a 16-year-old brother, sister, cousin, whatever. Signing them in the morning or picking them up in the afternoon.
I don't want to make it so onerous that you can't work, the rec program can't work, but I'm concerned about the liability that we take on. You know, I mean, that was the whole point right from the beginning, right? We were worried about kids just coming and going as they please, and I don't want to unfairly, you know, portray the former program, but the way it was presented to us, it didn't seem like a lot of controls.
Right.
And I thought that's what we were trying to alleviate. So, I mean, I understand in the real world that it may be practical for some of these concessions to be made, but I don't know if that's what we want to do. And that's one of the main reasons we were so concerned about the other program, right? So,
my personal opinion is this year, no, because we have to get our feedback on the ground.
Yeah, I don't disagree with that.
And unfold and unravel this and grow it again.
Yeah, yes.
I think we can revisit that next year, but we really have to make sure that our children are protected
yeah.
because like I said yesterday, it's gonna be too early for my kids. I'm dropping them off at Megan's house, and Megan's bringing on four.
So, what did the rec committee think? Are they wanting us to do this? Just curious.
Celia was there.
The previous meeting, we had a discussion about it, and the rec committee was split, but in the end, they decided to hold off because they were worried about liability issues. And kids that showed up alone, the decision was made that they would have to stay at the check-in table. A call would go up to a responsible adult, and they would stay there. The child or children would stay at the checkout, check-in, check-out desk until a responsible adult gets there to sign them in and or out. So if it was all day, they would have to stay there because the committee felt like turning them away would also be a liability, because then you're saying, you got here,
I hear you,
and we can't sign you in because you have no adult, but we're going to release you back into the wild,
right, yeah, no,
sort of thing.
Yeah.
So the committee had voted on saying, you're here, let's make the call to tell people you're here and keep you safe until they get here.
So,
What about though the child that, well, you never know who's going to show up, right? You never know. So if you don't have an adult check them in, then a kid could, you know, a parent could think somebody's on his way and the kid never shows up.
Which right. Wasn't the watch.
Yeah. I'm gonna say, how many kids are dropped, we know, on average last year, how many were actually dropped off and how many didn't walk on their own?
I have no
more kids, yeah.
So what time, isn't there like a pre...
There's a pre-drop-off, 8 to 9.
Yeah.
So the early commitment is 8. And as late as, what did we say, 5? 4 to 5. It's late.
Well, I'm inclined to agree with, you know, what you think, Jody, and I think what I'm hearing from Michael, that you know, we're trying to get this program, you know, reinstated, back on solid ground. There are a lot of new things that are going to, you know, new people, new everything, and so we probably should err on the side of caution. That's kind of what I'm...
And if we're, you know, we can revisit it next year. I mean, you're right. This is a brand new program that is still in development. I think we are on the side of caution.
Okay.
We've been doing that a lot today.
So. Yes.
I thought we were taking a risk going against the governor.
Yeah, I mean, not on this one.
That's our big leap for today.
Yeah.
So, and then... We didn't allow 14 and 15 year old employees this year. But they, at that age, they do need volunteer hours for their high school volunteer requirement. So the rec committee was thinking that they could come in and, you know, demo a skill. Like if you're in the scouts, how to tie, or, you know, you know how to braid hair, or
something like that. Okay,
educate the kids for like a
they'd be supervised by the actual
counselors. Yeah.
Sure.
One of the, we actually asked one of the counselors that was there last year, she was at the meeting, and we said, well, what was it like having 14 and 15 year old counselors? And she said, they were just like the kids, they were on their phones all the time.
Yeah. That's...
So having them as volunteers, I don't want to burden them either. So I didn't think it was a good idea to have them there all day.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, come in, do a demo or something like that. You know, maybe at the end of the day, sweep the floors or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I would be inclined to leave that to the discretion of the program director.
Okay.
I mean, coming in as volunteers for an hour or two a day, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But I don't think, if it didn't really work, having them as full counselors,
right.
I don't think it's going to get any better this year. So.
Right. I checked with the police, background checks, because we are allowing 16 to 18 year olds. But if you do a background check on a 16-year-old, the records are sealed. So unless you do a local something, they can't bring up anything other than local. So just FYI.
But will they be asking the local
school
departments
reference?
For...
There, anybody 16 to 18 needs 3 references.
Okay.
But I'm sorry, but are we running their names by the police department, local police department, just to make sure there isn't like a known... issue with any of the...
Well, that was the question.
Today.
Are we going to pay for a background check to have it come back blank anyway?
Well, that I get.
Yeah.
That you can send
but
it to the state police and they can't give you anything, but
right.
If our chief
Can he say anything?
He can even say anything, like, you know, you may want to reconsider.
Yeah, I asked him this morning when we were waiting to get started, and he said that only local stuff I can give you, so.
But he might, he could look at the names and see.
Yeah.
Do that.
So that'll give us some money on the background checks. And how do you guys feel about cell phones at the camp?
At all, in general?
For the campers.
I would think that they can bring, to my personal opinion, I mean, you know, this is just Mike Willow's utopia, I guess, but I'd like no more cell phones in general, but I would say that they can bring them with them, that's fine if there's an emergency, but they should have to give them to the head counselor or something.
With the group, like, I want my kid.
What's the point? They're just gonna sit there texting or looking at kids open blind bags on YouTube is what.
Understood, but as a parent, I'm not a parent, but I mean, I know parents who have provided cell phones to their children for security reasons. So if that's the preeminent reason, then the phone should at least be close to the, you know what I mean?
Okay, well then, I mean, if there is an actual safety concern for that child, they have to have a phone, because, you know, there's an extenuating, I can't speak, because you know, instead of circumstances, I would think you could work that out with the director ahead of time. It's not like, you know.
Director discretion, or are we willing enough to go?
I don't know enough to, I'm just sort of doing my own thing, but I mean, what do other camps do? Do we know?
Where my children go, no cell phone, they're allowed at all.
They can't even bring them.
Nope. Well, if they do, they go right to the desk.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I could see picking them up and returning them.
Right, and then it's like, who's watching the cell phones all the way?
There's that too, right? There's a liability there too, right?
Right. So, and some of the parents were adamant that, you know, my eighth grader, I want him to have, or her to have a cell phone on them. So I can call them and say, hey, I'm coming to get you in 10 minutes, be ready.
They can't call the camp and say that? I mean, I don't understand.
Just relaying.
I have, no, I can do that.
I mean,
I'm not at that point yet with Elizabeth, so.
I would look for guidance from other camps, you know, that have a similar age.
One back, do you mind if we ask?
One suggestion.
Everyone else here are parents too, so.
One suggestion put out was that they have to remain in the bags, but then.
Who watches them, right?
That gets back to the.
They're supposed to watch their own stuff, right? Their own bag, you mean their own pack, their own bags.
So they could come, but they have to remain in the bag during camp hours. And my feeling is, as a parent, that it remains in the bag.
Do they carry their bag all day?
And then if it comes out of the bag and becomes an issue, then the camp director can take it away. And there is a behavior management policy in the parent handbook that maybe the committee needs to review and put something in there for cell phones.
I know when Santa did the Sims music camp at University of New Hampshire, which was a residential camp for 14, 15-year-olds for music, at 14, she was actually the only child who went to camp that year who did not have a cell phone. And I felt so guilty and bad about it when the camp contacted me and said, that is how we keep track of the kids on campus. How would you like us to keep track of where your daughter
with
is?
With a cell phone?
I actually drove over to UNH that day, and that was how she got her cell phone. Because every other kid at that age, 14, 15, 16, had their phones.
Mm-hmm.
The issue I have with the phones is, if the idea of the camp is to have the kids engaged in doing something besides phones, mm-hmm. You know, if I were in charge, I would say the phones have to be dealt with in some other way than people having their phones. You know, and I don't know that they have to physically be removed from them, but I would certainly hope that the counselors and the director are going to have some training around how to manage that situation, and that they're going to be providing programming and, you know, kind of a set of values and a culture that says we're not doing this here. So like in your way of saying we're going to experiment this year and see, you know, let's go for that. And, you know, I know a few things about that. I mean, if they want to talk about it, we could talk about some ways that they could manage that and everybody learn how to do that and then go from there and try that. But the other thing I wanted to say about the dropping off thing is there are some incredibly well-run camps in our area, and I think we're trying to compete with them. We want to draw some of that market from Camp Wildcat and the one mm-hmm. in South Berwick, and I think we should be looking at exactly what they're doing
mm-hmm.
and copy it directly as our experiment. When we set up the library, we looked at the best libraries in the state, and we cherry-picked exactly what we wanted to do as our base, because why reinvent the wheel and try to figure it out and learn the hard way? So that drop-off thing, I know that was a big thing you wanted to address. I would be right over at South Burr to get all their paperwork. I would look up online the Camp Wildcat stuff from Durham, and I would just copy it. Because I'm sure they have the same questions.
Exactly.
My concern would be a liability to the town. I mean, if we don't, you know, cover our you-know-whats from A to Z on this, and we have the one horrible thing that happens and we get sued over it, that would really be my concern. Not to be crass about the children as well, but I think we want to be thinking about that if we're setting up this new thing and we're trying to have a new, really high standard for it. So find somebody's rules and copy them.
Yes, and that's what they've been doing.
Yeah.
But depending on what issue they're talking about is what town they pick it from.
Yeah.
Well, and they're going to have their own little individual.
Of the stuff came from Barrington, but this happened to be from the Summer Shore. So I still feel strongly about everybody has to be signed in this year for some sort of an adult. But
okay.
We still didn't
Good.
Answer 16 and up. Can the 16-year-old go and get their brother or sister?
Mm. No. So again, based on my experience at the library, there are a lot of older kids in this town who do take care of their brothers and sisters in the summer, and they would often walk the younger ones down and be responsible for them and walk them back. And I would be sad to see that part of our audience left out of this for parents who might need it the most. Because I think initially this whole camp got started way back when to help those kids that might not have access to things that a lot of other kids do. And 16 is pretty responsible.
Yeah, people are babysitting at that age.
People have jobs
right.
at 16.
And I see that in the village too, the older siblings taking care of the younger siblings. I mean, that's just.
All right, I guess we've opened this up, so
no,
we'll open it up. We'll try to.
One
round for everybody. That's
one
it.
Committee member pointed out last night her 16-year-old could drive. But our 16-year-old cannot sign their siblings out of the camp.
Nancy?
As long as the parent signs a consent.
Right, I think that was part of
right.
the, yeah, that's one of the things.
That child can pick up the and sign for that child. Because I know that when my grandchildren were in the Y, they had to give the Y a consent paper for me to be able to sign them out.
All right, so is that helpful?
Have we much sufficiently muddied enough?
No, they can be on the pickup list, the 16-year-old.
Yeah, but they, as long as the parents have said that that's
okay.
That's
so, and Christine made this whole
look at this.
Poster for us.
Is that cool or what?
This is going to be on their shirt.
Uh-huh.
And they're going to be selling gray shirts to everybody in town to sponsor and
that's
help
right.
out. Cover the costs.
Yeah.
Kristen Palaco,
yes.
right? Let's give her
yes.
full
yes.
her full due. Kristen
yeah.
Palaco. She's
and
a wonderful graphic artist.
And
yeah.
she was working very hard with Celia on shirt design and colors and everything else.
Awesome.
The same Kristen Palaco who has redone our town seal,
yes.
just so people can make that connection
yeah.
as well.
And Seagulls Printing is giving us a wonderful deal on
Excellent.
It as well.
Awesome. Will they be for sale at the meeting on Saturday? Or?
We can pre-register for them. They won't be ready till April 12th.
But we can buy them on?
To
June 12th.
June 12th.
They,
we have
Same
to pre-order.
Cash for Saturday, that's all.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
And if you don't have your cash, we'll then want you to
take a check.
The t-shirt orders will be open from town meeting through May 20th.
Okay.
And then for community members, and community members will have gray shirts, and they will be available June 12th. And then the campers and the counselors will have blue shirts. So that way somebody can't buy a shirt for their kid and then that kid show
right,
up unregistered to camp.
Sure.
I'm going on a field trip.
But this gives the community a chance to support the
yeah.
camp.
I know this is an unanswered question, but I think this rec committee, I think we've all been doing a great job.
Excellent.
Trying
it's nice to see this
corral
energy
this.
And
yeah.
it's been a lot of fun actually.
This, you know, this is kind of a fun thing.
Try to corral them during the meeting. You have to watch the meetings. They are so much fun. So, and then...
we still have the job descriptions.
Karen, yes. They redid them just last night. She just sent them out this morning. I have not really looked at it. She did take all your edits and fix them.
Okay.
But I did not look at them yet. and.
Work study, was this, I think there's something we're supposed to sign, and I don't think we found it.
Yes, it's in my drawer. There is something we have to sign to send over to New Hampshire, UNH. And then the other thing was the money management.
Did I send to you or the committee the recommendations from our auditor?
I'm gonna say I don't know.
But I'm gonna say I don't know either, so why don't I.
We sent out a lot of emails today.
Why, well, this would have been too, you know, it would have been right after the auditor.
Yes.
And I said that I thought we should have the committee chairs anyway come in and talk, so that, because, you know, he had some really specific things. And, you know, maybe, personally, I'm not tied to each one of those specific things, I'm tied to the overall motivation of what, you know, what he's trying to accomplish. So if there's other ways to provide that same level of control that he's looking for. So that's why I thought it'd be good to have a conversation with the committee chairs, I think, and the board about the auditor's recommendations.
Yeah, so right now the question was making the checks out. Do you make the check out to Wellsburg Rec, or do you make it out to Town Wellsburg? And I said Town Wellsburg because the dog goes into one fund.
I agree with you.
We don't have that checking account anymore, or we won't.
Did you just agree to that too?
Okay.
Okay, yeah, we all agree.
So, okay. That's what I thought, but I wanted to double check.
It made the most sense to me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so is that, have we answered the committee questions right now?
Yes, and then just this, they're thinking of a half-day program for teens, but we're gonna worry about that more towards closer to summer, and let's just get this one off the ground first.
Okay, all right.
Did I forget anything?
No, I'll ask it. That's all.
Okay. Credit cards, that's here just to, it's a placeholder for the time being. Bid review, we did have a public meeting this morning with Steve Height, who's our, from Civil Works, New England, who's our engineer on the town hall drainage process, and we reviewed the bids, and he explained to us, I mean, the outlier was probably a miscalculation on the part of the vendor or contractor, but that's the way it goes. And he explained the other two bids as really being pretty much equivalent. And the $10,000 difference was largely because one was located in Sunapee and had to figure in transportation, and the other was located here in town. So we're delighted that the low bid is a town contractor, mm-hmm. and who understands that we won't be making the final determination until after town meeting. But that's the bid that we are considering. Anything else on that bid process? Okay. Request for transfer station pass for cardboard. So I know about this. Does the board?
Oh, I saw an email. Yeah.
Yeah. So we got an email from Caroline that the where Paul's used to be, the new garage up there. He's looking to dump cardboard at our transfer station, and cardboard is a revenue stream,
right.
And so he's not looking to do anything else. And so Caroline wondered if we wanted to have our town clerk write a letter that allows him to dump bring cardboard to the transfer station.
As long as it's only cardboard.
Only cardboard.
Yeah.
So he's not gonna have a sticker, he's just gonna have a letter saying I can dump
cardboard. Yes.
Oh. So if he doesn't have a sticker, he can't bring anything else.
I know, but I just worry.
About?
Well, once you're in the door, it's much easier. So they start knowing you, they know your face, you come in with cardboard every week, and then you don't even think twice about it, that's just,
so you're concerned
that they're coming in and throwing his trash away.
Yeah.
And now he starts throwing away trash.
Yeah. So there's that risk.
That's my risk. That's my worry. And we don't really have a good management of the transfer station to begin with. So we're trusting our employees quite a bit. So.
Well, that's always the case.
Yeah.
So you think?
Just my devil's advocate.
Yeah. So Mike, what do you think?
I like the idea of the revenue.
Yeah. See, I always I love the idea of added revenue.
Right.
So I look at that and go, okay, yay.
Right.
So I'm listening, but I'm listening now, I'm listening
right.
to the rest.
No, I mean, is that a revenue, but is there a random risk as well, I think, is the question.
Yeah. And does one outweigh the other?
Right.
We can, you know, one thing we could do is check with Jeff.
Yeah, I mean, it can be issued month to month, too, that's coming for a new letter. And if there's issues, I mean.
Well, so, what I thought, I mean, that's a good idea. What I thought is, let's check with Jeff and see, is this something that the transfer station attendants think that they can control?
It's a good point. Wait till next week to ask.
Yeah, well, I can send him an email when he's ready. So we can do that as a next step. Does that seem reasonable next step? Where is it?
Highway shed, go highway shed.
Oh, yeah. Highway shed. Jody?
Yes, we're putting that out to bid. Unfortunately, I did not get to, I wrote up most of it, I just didn't have a map of lot and address. With a 3-month, they have to get it off the premises within 3 months.
Have the acceptance of the bid?
Yeah. And come to find out, I asked around how much it would take for us to get rid of it. It was thousands of dollars, and I'm like, great, so it's saving us money.
Five or six, wasn't it?
Yeah, so we're going to be, because as long as we have no other use for that building, and all of the departments said absolutely not.
And all of the departments being, just so we're clear, Jeff? Fire and police. So the, I don't imagine the library would.
The one on Silver Street?
The old one.
Someone would pay to take that down?
They want to make
one off building. So.
If you're good about tearing things down like that, you can rebuild them, pretty much, so. I'll do it tomorrow.
So how much time are we giving them? 2 weeks?
It's supposed to be 2 weeks, unfortunately, so now they'll have a week, but.
Well, we can do it 2 weeks.
Push it out.
Push it out, there's no.
It's okay.
Yeah. That would be fine. Okay. Excellent, so we're good with that?
So we just have to keep in mind the demolition cost when we're examining the bids at the point.
Yes.
Makes sense.
There was also, I don't know if you caught it, sometime in the last week, there was something from DES. They're obviously reviewing the Preterain, the brownfields, the people who are doing the brownfields report, report. So it looks like it was just an FYI for us, I think. I don't think it required us to do anything. They were asking some questions of Preterain about Preterain.
I gotcha, yeah.
It has nothing to do with the shed, it's the soil and,
Right.
You know, what testing they did, has there been another use of the, those kinds of things. I mean, some questions may come back to us, but they were directed to us. All right, non-lapsing account, that's an item we're just putting, placeholder. Impact fees, I didn't see John tonight, so I'm going to remove this going forward, and we'll just see what the planning board wants to do.
I think so.
Okay. Nothing, no updates on the policies and procedures, so I guess we're at standing items. So, board member activities and updates. Well, we are not helping to supervise an election tomorrow. Instead, the board is helping to supervise an election on Thursday.
Right.
From 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. And then on Saturday, we will all congregate at the Rollinsford Grade School for the business part of town meeting. So those are the main things that we are doing this week.
Yeah, I've got a TAC meeting, I guess TAC.
Yes.
One of them, at Stratford Regional Planning on Friday. But I think it's just, if you don't mind, we just briefly talk about today. And we had our public meeting this morning, but so we had the opportunity to be on a call at noon with the with Director Plummer of Department of Homeland Security here in the state. They're activating the Emergency Operations Center, EOC, at 4 o'clock tomorrow for the storm, simply. But anyways, in other business, we're expecting between 12 and 18 inches of snow on the low side. Let's hope that's the high end, but from what the National Weather Service said, I wouldn't, I don't think we're gonna count on that. They're reevaluating their models, they say constantly, so.
Well, I think the dramatic piece of that too is the rate at which it was going to fall.
Yeah, 2 to 3 inches, up to 4 in some places an hour.
Possibly 4 inches an hour, so.
30 to 40 mile an hour winds, I mean, it's gonna be dramatic tomorrow, so.
And as the Department of Transportation said, they can't clear that quickly.
Can't keep up enough.
Yes.
And they're not gonna be able to, Jeff and his crew are not gonna be able to keep up any faster than DOT can, so, if it comes down. So, that was pretty clear, after hearing that call at 2, or 12, rather, it's pretty clear to me, we were making the right decision by postponing. We thought we'd hold off until the governor, actually, the way it was billed was that the Attorney General was going to brief us at 2, but turns out the governor himself did it, answered questions, which was nice. His recommendation, well, he qualified it several times, was that we should just hold the election, was his preference, and then he qualified that by saying he has no authority to compel us to do that, and there was enough ambiguity in the law that he understood why municipalities would make the decisions they made. There was no consensus in the city of Concord, apparently, between the Attorney General, the Secretary of State, even people within the Secretary of State's office, within the Attorney General's office, within the governor's office.
There was a lot of confusion.
Within the leadership of the legislature. I mean, literally, there were dozens of opinions, right? I mean, that was safe. I mean, you were on the call too, at 2.
Yes.
I think we made the right decision.
It was great ambiguity.
So, yeah.
And there were towns that had already made some decisions.
Right.
And towns that had been involved with cooperative school districts, where they all had to vote at the same time.
We don't worry about that.
And they had looked for guidance before, and they thought they had received it, and so.
The Secretary of State's office apparently changed its,
so.
its opinion. Last week there was, where was the gentleman from, Loudoun maybe? Somewhere over by Concord.
A cooperative school district with 6 towns.
And so they made, they wanted to be proactive.
Yeah.
And so they asked last week, you know, this weather's coming, Secretary of State, what do we do compared to the authority? Well, we don't regulate town elections, the moderators, that's exactly what the Municipal Association told us. And then all of a sudden today, Gardner changed his mind, and it was, so anyways, I think, I'm very confident in the decision that our moderator made, and I think we all back him up. I mean, the public safety, really, and ensuring the franchise, I mean, making sure people actually turn out is important, so. Sure, there will be some folks that aren't happy, but I'm willing to.
Well, it is the moderator's decision
right.
to make, just so we can have that on public
yes.
record, but. He did it in full consultation with the select board, with the town clerk, with the chief of police. So it was, you know, we're not letting him hang out to dry. This is a decision that we all supported and endorsed, but it was his decision to make, just so that. You know,
and he suffered for it.
And if there is any action, it's against us anyway.
Right.
Yes,
that's true.
So right,
and
his
we
decision, we get the blame.
We get
so
the blame,
it's not a bad place
but
to be.
But he didn't take the decision lightly. He really suffered with this decision, going back and forth.
Seriously.
Was he making the right decision? And I think ultimately he did. So, and I thank him for the service.
So that's where that stands. Thank you for that wrap up, Mike. So other things that are going on, there is right now a meeting scheduled for the Seacoast Stormwater Coalition that I
tomorrow
am part of. No, it's Wednesday, Wednesday at 1. So,
okay.
We'll
good luck.
But it's you know it has a lot of public works folks
right.
who participate. So we'll see if that goes on. And then you have TAC. When is your TAC?
Friday morning.
Yeah. So SRPC, I have a you know the policy meeting on that day too. What is 9?
It's
Transportation Advisory
Council.
Committee.
It's part of the SRPC.
It's a subgroup of Stratford Regional Planning. So Mike is now on TAP, which is good to have a town rep on that. I'm a commissioner, so I'm on the regular monthly policy committee and also a quarterly commission meeting. So I have my monthly policy meeting on Friday, so I guess they all took place unless I'm wrong. Anything for you, Madame?
No. Joint lunch doesn't meet again today, so.
Okay.
And rec meets again on the 26th.
All right. Very good. And you please do tell them that we're really excited.
Yeah.
It makes us smile, all these fun things that are
going on. Yeah, it is a fun coming in anyway.
All right, so that's it for standing, I mean, for board member activities, building permits?
Building permit, yeah, permit. The first one is 2017-013, 139 Woods Run. They are adding on to an existing purchase order, it says here.
Existing building permit.
What did I just say?
Purchase order.
Oh, for God's sake. I'm done apparently, that's what I meant. Existing building permit, they're adding a pool onto it now. The fee will be $405. It's been reviewed by Mr. Clark.
Have we already approved this?
The other building permit, this is, they're doing additional work now.
Okay.
What Tom said is.
All right.
Says submitted with building permit on application on 2/20/17. This is now for pool construction also, so.
Okay. And it must deal with the pool cover, right, and all that jazz. My building inspector is looking at that.
He's already, yeah.
It's on the back of the form, we know that now.
We know that, it has to have a fence, so. And the next one we have is 2017-015, 10 Wentworth Street. I would say it's lot 14, so I'm going to want to note that it's a new construction. Actually, there's a couple associated with it. They've already done the building permit itself. This is for gas. That's a $90 fee. It's for utilities. Mr. Clark did it here. They have a few more for plumbing and things like that. 2017-016, 10 Wentworth Street, also lot 14. Oh, electrician, so this is electrical work. Fee is $105.
Why isn't it $90?
Because the value is higher than the.
Than the default.
Than the default. $90 is the base. 2017-017, Mr. Clark's reviewed all of these, so I should say that. 35 Wentworth Street, lot number 5. Also electrical, $105. 2017-018, 38 Wentworth Street, lot number 7. Also electrical, $105, but I didn't mark that for some electrician. That's been reviewed by Mr. Clark. Okay, 2017-019, the last one, I think. 23 Wentworth Street, or lot 2. Also electrical, $105. It's all the same electrician, they're going to be busy people up there. You want me to keep going through my little folder here? All right. We have This is an abatement to the tax levy for 2016 in the amount of $1,810. It's cause of the abatement is database cleanup for mailing of 2017 residence tax invoices. It resulted in 181 residents being deleted from the database and are reflected on the attached report. I think in most cases it's either people have moved or they've aged out of having to file or pay their
the
resident tax.
The abatement is for the resident tax?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, I missed that, sorry.
Sorry, yeah. The warrant for the 2017 residence tax levy, that's a small one. This is obviously to charge folks the 2017 residence tax. It looks like it will bring in, the Andrea Cash collector of taxes. In the name of the state, you are hereby directed to collect the residence taxes in the list herewith committed to you, honored before the 1st of December, amounting in all the sum of $17,100. So that's what we can expect to, if everyone here pays their residence tax, we will collect. So. And we need to issue the warrant so she can actually levy the tax. There we have it. And we have two purchase orders in here.
Well, they're everywhere.
Someday we're going to get them all in one place.
Do you have to do something about that warrant?
We just did. We just
signed
it.
We're signing it. Okay.
Sorry, yeah, because we're signing it, we don't have to do a motion.
I wasn't visually observing.
Yeah, we are signing
just
it.
Listening.
Okay, so we have, on behalf of the tax collector, we have purchase order number 1180. This is the fee so she can attend the spring workshop for tax collectors for $50. It's payable to the New Hampshire Tax Collectors Association. And I would move, I should have said that first, sorry. Move purchase order 1180, $50.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Okay, so next is purchase order number 1181. It's for election day for the meals from the town clerk. It's to Homegrown Eats, which is a catering company in the mills, apparently.
Oh, really?
Yep. It's for $213.64. It's for assortments of sandwiches for lunch and then some sort of...
Should we call it?
Yeah, right. I'm confident Kate handled that.
I'm sure she's on it.
Some sort of pasta dish for dinner, I guess. So, anywho, for $213.
Did you move it?
I did, yes.
Second, sorry.
Any discussion? Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Apparently that is all we have in this folder for the
night. It's nice to have a homegrown, local, it's called Homegrown Eats. It's nice to have a local purveyor.
I think so.
We'll
contract with them again next year.
Yeah, are you aware of them?
No. And they must be in the mill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He lives on Silver Street.
Is that over?
Oh, okay. So, but are you done, Michael? Yeah. Okay. So,
I
have your resume.
Sorry, I don't know.
Oh, okay. Somebody told me about this. Maybe Caroline. So there are two things. So we have to. So if we approve this, we also have to sign the contract.
The contract.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
that's
generator service maintenance for downstairs.
It's for the whole. Yeah. It's for the.
Well, yeah. For the building.
It's for the building, and it has to do with public safety. It's the their.
Actually,
you know,
was brought up today that if something happens. And we were in a whole town election, we would have been kicked out anyway.
Yeah.
Because they wanted this.
That's right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. So we'll take that purchase order 1129 to generator connection for $580 for 1 year, for a two-year service agreement for preventative maintenance for generator.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 A yearly or bi-yearly expense?
That's a two-year agreement.
Yes.
Yeah. I just don't remember incurring it last year.
We may not have.
Generator connection.
Yes. Oh, we have to sign that too. Is it just one signature? Looks like, huh? All right. So I'm going to sign this contract or proposal. cable from generator connection.
So move to accept purchase order 1157 to Digital Inc. for 2,250 resident tax cards for a total of $297.74.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. And the last two in here are from last week. One is the Comcast renewal process that we'll do after town meeting. And this is DES stuff for after town meeting as well with the roads.
Yeah.
The roads?
Sign after town.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
got it.
Remember we were looking at the map.
That's right.
We had to add certain names to them and
yeah.
such.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.
That's it.
Do you have, you made photocopies for non-public data in there? I'll go get them if not.
They did not make it to this folder.
All right, I know where they are. Okay. I'll get them afterwards.
The things for us to take on the week?
Yeah, but we should discuss them.
We can. Well, let's do everything else and then we'll do that, okay?
Yeah.
All right, community info. Oh, okay. Charlie.
Thank you. I would like to compliment the town moderator and the select board for making a very wise decision on moving the election to Thursday.
Yeah, you're welcome.
It was not an easy decision, I know, but it's a common sense one.
Thank you.
It was collaborative. It was, and the town clerk was part of that decision, the police chief. So it was a collaborative effort, you know, and it's not easy sometimes because you've got all these state statutes and some of them do kind of go like this.
Yeah.
And this is sort of the kind of the legislative nest, that, you know, bird's nest that we were in today. And so, you know, hopefully, you know, the governor will talk to the legislature. You know, Michael thinks that the statutes are clear, but obviously some people think they're not. And so to the extent that the legislature can help provide some additional clarity on that, that would be helpful. So, Celia?
Mm-hmm. I was just going to say, we're too small a town to handle two things like that at once. We don't have the resources.
Handle which two things?
A snowmageddon.
Oh, yeah.
An election.
Yeah.
We don't have enough people.
Correct.
And, you know, somebody would have been hurt. And it was extremely smart. I was glad I was here to see it. I was so impressed, and I agree with Charlie. You did a great job.
Thank you.
Actually, I just checked the weather. They're calling it bombogenesis, which is a very rare weather situation where the number of millibars that the pressure drops is more faster than one per hour, and they're predicting that it will drop by 30 points. Leading up to the storm. So that's where the massive amount of snow could come. And we're not in 18 anymore, we're 24 to 30. Because it only happens every 100 years.
Last time National Weather Service talked to us, it was.
If you look at the weather map, there's like this like fuchsia, looks like a giant bruise circling over us. And I saw bombogenesis, I'm like, oh God, the weather's they're making something up. But it's actually literally has to do with millibars of pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a real thing. So
how many inches again?
24 to 30.
There are towns there are towns that are holding their election tomorrow, probably because of what was announced today and by the Secretary of State. And God love them all, and hope everybody stays safe.
Yeah.
I completely agree.
We're supposed to be getting 55 mile an hour winds with it as well.
No,
I think we all want this to be over, the election to be over, one way or another. But no one wants anyone to get hurt.
The other thing I can tell you is that on the social media that I follow, that people are very grateful, and they were all saying proactively before you did it, I really hope they do it, and afterwards people were really grateful that you did it. I didn't see one person say, oh my God, I can't believe we're not going to vote tomorrow. So I don't.
We tried to get the word out to as much as possible to various groups. I know that Tia got it out right away. I mean, it came out later in the day because we kept waiting for what we hoped was a definitive word. And So it just took us a little bit longer than we thought even, but once it was made, I mean, Tia posted it right away. I can only assume that, you know, we made attempts to get Channel 9 and TSN and Foster's involved, but, you know, the rest of the...
I got three emails, too, from different people that I know that put me in a group that were emailing friends who may not use social media as well. So I think people are really taking Charlie's advice.
Please make sure your neighbors know.
Our neighborhood association, Sue Hall, who was in one night for something else, she actually sent it out to everybody in the neighborhood, too, so you know.
Excellent, that's wonderful.
So I'll go next, cellular labels, but mine took Charlie's warning because I know my neighbors are not on social media. Walked across the road, knocked on their door, said, please don't go tomorrow, go Thursday instead. And they have children in the town who I'm sure they'll contact too, who are on social media. But I have a couple other questions. The town report has a bunch of committee reports, but it doesn't have one for the rec committee.
We had never reported one for rec committee ever, so I did not think this was the year to present one.
Okay.
So the rec committee that was in place for the rec activities of 2016 was no longer a place to write the report, is one way to think of that. Mm-hmm. And I will also abide by what you said, that if they hadn't done anything in the past, or at least the recent past. So but next year will be a new year. And so we'll be able to...
We wouldn't have been able to give them numbers. We wouldn't have been able to give them fees. We wouldn't have been able to give them anything. Yeah. So...
Okay. And then I have another question. On cell phones for the rec committee, did you give a definitive answer that no, or was it just at the discretion of the counselors? I wasn't clear on that.
Discretion of the director.
Director.
Okay. Thank
and
you.
And with the advice to look, you know, look at other...
Programs.
Thank you.
Since the balloting has been moved to Thursday, is the town clerk open on Wednesday to give out absentee ballots for people who may not be here Thursday?
No, I don't think so. Okay. The town.
I think
that time has passed.
Okay.
She was here till 5 o'clock today to accept them.
Right. So you know, there are regulations and windows and this sort of thing. So we made no change to absentee ballots in this conversation we had today, just the physical election. And Kate did say that she had received all the absentee ballots that had gone out.
Because there was mention of it on the MUR site that the governor was suggesting that somebody be available to hand out absentee ballots if the polls were
tomorrow
changing.
Tomorrow at the polls, yeah. And
that doesn't work because it would have to be Kate. She has to be the one to input it into the computer and all that stuff. It doesn't work. Yeah.
I didn't bring it up, actually. The governor did mention that in the call. And there was a lot of pushback, actually, from lawyers and moderators saying, well, Governor, we understand that, but for a number of reasons, but not to mention just the statutes, but for safety, if we're not asking, part of the public safety, if we don't want our town clerks and other folks, elected officials, having to be at the polls any more than we want the general public. So, I mean, he understood that too. I mean, it was just a suggestion.
He did say it again though on the 5 o'clock.
Yeah, but it's not a requirement; it's a suggestion.
He implied by the way that he said it that it would happen. So that was my concern: is that now everybody's going to think in all these towns that canceled, that if they show up, they'll get an absentee ballot.
He said that on the call at first, and then when someone, sort of questioned him, like, "Well, Governor, can we do that?" He said, well, this is my suggestion, right? Didn't say it's a requirement. Mm-hmm. So
it was the same way that he recommended that we continue to hold town elections on Tuesday.
Right.
But then in the absence of that, if we had already planned something else, if we chose to do it, then, it was his strong recommendation.